It's good to be with you this morning, thank you for spending this beautiful, sunny, wintry morning with us. And it's a privilege for us to be able to gather together here in person, and for those of you who are able to connect with us online, we really appreciate that, your desire to grow in your relationship with the Lord and to discover a little bit more about His great love for you. And so we look forward to having a good morning this morning together. And just as we start, let me just share a couple of things before we pray together. When you're coming in and on the counters, there's a new magazine from our denomination. It's called EMCC Together. And it's the theme in this issue is growing in Christ-like character. And you can also find a link to that magazine, on the emcc.ca website. And I'll just encourage you, if you want to pick one up and take it, that's great. And then going forward, we'll probably put a link to it in our e-bulletin as well so that you can access that. But you can always go to the website and grab that in addition to that. And so thank you for that. And then also just to share with you that next Sunday is January 28th, and we're having our soup luncheon next Sunday, and there's some instruction there for 8 a.m. You can please bring, if your last name begins with A to M, then you can bring a dessert, and if your last name begins with N to Z, then you can bring a salad. We have people who are making soup. We have people who are serving. Thank you so much for offering to serve in that way. And so we look forward to a great time together next Sunday. And thanks for that. Throughout the course of this month, we are receiving your donations towards the various food banks in our city. And so as you come, whether you come on Sundays or you come during the week for other things, let me encourage you to bring non-perishable food items, because, you know, there's a lot of emphasis on helping those in need over the Christmas season, but turns out that people are still need to eat in January as well, and so we want to be able to help meet those needs that are around at this time as well. And so any cash donations that you submit through e-transfer, then those to our benevolence fund, or if you mark them food drive, then they will also be distributed to our local food banks as they serve those most in need over the course of this next little while. So thank you for that. And then a really good reminder: last week our upward practices started, and on Monday and Thursday. This week, our practices continue, but then our games start this Saturday. And so here's a way that you can be involved if you're not physically in the building coaching or teams or refereeing or volunteering in person on Saturday. Here's another way that you can be involved. At 10 o'clock, right? First game's at 10 o'clock. At 10 o'clock, at 11 o'clock, at 12 o'clock, at 1 o'clock, at 2 o'clock, at 3 o'clock, and at 4 o'clock. Did I get all that right? We don't have 4? At 3 o'clock. Let's try that again. At 10 o'clock, at 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, and 3 o'clock, a new game starts on the top of every hour, every Saturday for the next 9 or 10 weeks. Would you, if you are not here, would you commit to just praying for our students, our student athletes, and their parents as they interact here with one another and as they hear a testimony or a devotional or a message from the Word of God? Would you pray that the life of Jesus is shared, that the gospel goes out for at the top of those hours? That would be a wonderful, wonderful way that you could contribute in a tangible way to what God is doing. So thank you for that. And I want us to say thanks to our team and for all that they do, and for those who served here last week, for Steve Bork for coming from Family Life Canada to share with us, and I trust that you were encouraged by what Steve had to share as well. And so and for those who serve, for Matt DaCosta for doing announcements. Matt, thanks. And for our team for working together, there's a technical thing. They worked together, they got it done, and I appreciate that. And for your prayer for me as I travel to El Salvador, just returning yesterday, and I'll share more about that trip in a few minutes' time. But just thank you for your partnership in that as well. So as we start today, let's listen to the Word of God and just go to prayer. I'm going to read from Psalm 62, starting in verse 5. Yes, my soul finds rest in God. My hope comes from Him. Truly, He is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to Him, for God is our refuge. Surely the low-born are but a breath, the high-born are but a lie. If weighed on a balance, they are nothing. Together, they are only a breath. Do not trust in extortion or put vain hope in stolen goods. Though your riches increase, do not set your hearts on them. One thing God has spoken, two things I have heard. Power belongs to you, God, and with you, Lord, is unfailing love. And you reward everyone according to what they have done. Let's pray together. So, Father, as we gather here this morning, as we gather, we recognize that our souls sometimes are not at rest. That often we get distracted in the pursuits of our hearts and the anxiousness that comes from the circumstances of life. So, God, would you help us to quiet our souls and find refuge in you. That you are the one who will shelter us. You are the one who will provide nourishment for our soul. That in you we find strength. And so would you listen to our heart's cry this morning? Would you pry open our hands from the things that we hold that we think only we can control? Would you help us, God, to honor you with all that we are and all that we do? We thank you for the freedom that you give us to gather here in this space on the corner of East and Telford. And we pray, Father, that as we come today, that you would be at work in and among us. Would you teach the one beside me and the one in front and the one behind? God, would you help us all to grow in our desire to live for you with all the days of our life? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Sorry, I keep not doing that. Sorry, Caitlin. We're going to sing giving thanks to the Lord and singing praise to Him together today.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For His might is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Mighty hand and outstretched arm. His love endures.
Psalm 104 says, "Let my whole being bless the Lord. Lord, my God, how fantastic you are. You are clothed in glory and grandeur. You wear light like a robe. You open the skies like a curtain. You build your lofty house on the waters. You make the clouds your chariot, going around on the wings of the wind. You make the winds your messengers. You make fire and flame your ministers. You establish the earth on its foundations so that it will never, ever fall."
Thank you.
Well, thanks for that good singing. Appreciate that for Amanda and Jarrett and Heather. Thanks for leading us this morning. And so at this time, we're going to have Michaela head out for Kid Jam with our teachers and leaders and our kids. If you're age 2 to grade 6, then you can make your way out and down the stairs to Kid Jam. And for parents of the 2, 3, 4, and 5-year-olds, you'll have to sign them in and then sign them back out at the end of the service, okay? Don't forget that. That's great. I love that sound. So thankful for the opportunity to do that. And so as they head off, I just want to share with you just for a couple of minutes, just a couple of highlights from my trip to El Salvador last week. And Nathan, you can put up that first picture. I think it's a good reminder that since 2009, we have been involved in this work in El Salvador. And our goal at the start of this was to be part of something that God was doing and commit to it for a long number of years in order to see self-sustainability in the country that we would be working with. And the Lord led us to this relationship with El Salvador. And over the years, since 2009, we have taken... we have sent teams down there to be part of this work. And so can I just say on behalf of our shelter team, just thank you for your encouragement and enthusiasm and involvement and in participation in this. And to know that God is making a difference in the lives of men and women and boys and girls in that country, it's an exciting thing to be part of that. And last year alone, we sent a team, if you remember, all the way back last January, and Abigail is on that team, and so back at the first week of January, and it's hard, so we built the first houses of that year. How many houses did we build? Does anybody remember? Do you guys remember how many houses we built that year? The 12? Is 12 a good number? Yeah. All right, I don't remember. 12? Sure, let's pick 12. So the 12 in week one, we were part of that. You know how many houses were built by teams in El Salvador together with those people and the families who were receiving them over the course of 2023? 732. It's the most ever. The most ever. In 2023, we hit 732. That's over 20, almost 2,400 people have been moved into safe housing, protected from the rains, protected, secure from danger, safety, and security for their families as well. And we know that when we build houses, that their health improves, and educational opportunities improve, and safety within the community improves. And so those are things that, and all the way along, those are all the way along, at every step of the way, they are reminded this is being done in the name of Jesus. And they are essentially discipled into how to understand what it means that God has not forgotten them, that God sees them and wants to bless them and encourage them for their lives. And so that's what we get to be part of. And so just to share a little bit about that. And so our goal this year, and we have a team going in April, from April 6th to 14th. And that originally was scheduled for the first week of January this year, but the cost of flights just got too high, so we've pushed it to that first week of April. And so we get to be part of what the Lord wants to do, and the goal that we've set for this year is to build homes with 900 families. And you know, coming out of this week, there's no good reason as to why the Lord wouldn't provide for that, and that's the feeling of all those who are gathered. So there was about 31 of us came from Canada and the U.S. It's a new development that we're going to be starting a team, hopefully, Lord willing, within this next year. Teams will start coming from the United States as well. And so God is doing something good, and we have been part of it. We have been part of it almost since the beginning. That's a really good thing. Go to the next one there, Nathan, please. And so one of the things, so there's our team there. One of the really amazing things that we got to do this past week, is go and see the location for a new hub from which we'll start to be building houses. And so that's located, for those of you who have traveled with us there or familiar with some of our stories, we've been based in the city of San Vicente, and this is about almost 2 hours away in a little town. We'll be based in a little town called Alegria in Berlin, and then in the communities that we went to visit. It's high up in the mountains, and the communities that we went to visit where we will be building houses, Lord willing, by the end of the last quarter of this year. Their houses have there's no electricity, there's no water supply. They gather these massive containers that gather rainwater, and then they distribute them like jug by jug throughout the rest of the year. They gather the rainwater in the rainy season, and it lasts through the rest of the year. And so there's no water, and there's no electricity, and there's a great need in that area. And so while they are materially poor, as some of you know, in relationship to how we might think, and there's a richness of hospitality and relationally and generosity among them that is just so powerful. And so it's great to be able to share in that. And so we got to tour a little bit, walk through this community, and then we went to this lookout above the community, and we're able to pray over the community as well, as we trust the Lord to go before us in this. And so this past week, just we had, as team leaders, this is our team leader week, and we have our annual meeting there. We built 15 homes in the community. I'll share a story a little later on this morning about one of those families that we built for. And just the opportunity to reflect a little bit, maybe of some significant news to you, might be those of you who are familiar with Stuart and Carrie McAllister, who have been directing the work at Shelter Canada. Many of you have met them when you've gone down, or maybe you've heard their names. They are going to be transitioning out of their CEO role, their leadership role, in El Salvador by June of 2025, July of 2025. So they've given us about a year and a half, just over a year and a half, to be able to work through that transition. So that's a way that you can be praying in the midst of all of this, momentum and growth that the Lord has seen fit to take place. They also are transitioning. Their kids by that time will all be university age, if you can believe that, for those of you who may have met them years and years ago, and so they'll be moving back to Canada. And so we are engaging in a search for a new CEO, new leadership for Shelter over the course of this next time. And Lord willing, we'll have that person or persons, depending on the model, in place by January of 2025, and they'll have a six-month overlap with Stuart and Carrie before they head home. It's also been my privilege to sit on the board of Shelter since its inception almost 12 years ago. And this past week, I tendered my resignation to sitting on the board there as well. And that they knew that in advance that was coming. And I just want to say thank you to you, to our leadership here, our governing board of the church, who have permitted me and afforded me the time to be part of that board, and also to all of you as a church family for supporting that and praying into that. And stepping out of it was not easy. And if you can imagine, I may have cried. I'll still obviously be involved, and we're leading teams. We'll be there in April, and we're going to have a team that's going to be getting ready soon to start preparing to go in November, so I'll still be connected to it. But just really felt that it is time for new insight and new perspectives to be shared on the board. And so I'd actually said about 4 years ago, right before the pandemic, it was minus 50 degrees in Edmonton. We had a board meeting in January of 2020. And I said to them there, I think I only have a year left. But then the pandemic came and it didn't feel like it was the right time. And then there was some family crises among some of our board members. And so it wasn't the right time. We were not very stable as a board. And so as an organization, we're healthy. And as a leadership team, we're healthy. And so this felt like the right time. And as the Lord has also given us the desire to build this greater glass company endeavor as well, the time that is required for that, I'll kind of switch gears in emphasis there as well. So that's a little bit. A few people asked me, because I asked about praying for a prayer request for weather. So if you remember back a week ago, Friday and Saturday, weather was not so good here. Turns out I missed winter last week. Saturday was snowy and it was windy. It was a slow crawl. My flight was leaving from London. It was a slow crawl to London, but everything flew on time. And so thank you for your prayer. They were incredibly bumpy rides because the winds were like 80 kilometers an hour. And even the big planes, Colin, were getting blown around. There are a few people using those little bags in the front, you know what I'm saying? And so always amazed when you get touched down after a flight like that. So for you and your kind, Colin, thank you. But I made it on time, and then yesterday, everything was smooth. It was smooth all the way through. And so thank you for that, for your prayer for that. It's a great joy to be part of what God is doing in these different parts of the world. And it's exciting to see, right, when you kind of loose our confinement of what we think or expect or our preferences, and we just want to say, where are you at work, and how are you changing lives? Boy, that just energizes me. Being in 40 degree heat also energizes me, actually. So I'm thankful for that as well. And so my greetings to you from those who are familiar, that many of you are familiar with in El Salvador, and to us as a church family as well. I was encouraged by some of our workers there who watch our services because of our connection. And so Dios te bendiga, la bendiga to you, and just thank you for all that you do and your prayer for us as well, to our family in El Salvador. Lord willing, we'll see you in April. And so I think with that, we'll have our music team come back and just lead us in one more song. How about that?
I'm looking up. Oh, there. Yay. There, we figured out the microphone. I'm sorry about that, everybody. We're going to sing one more song together right now before Dave comes back to speak. If you're able to, I'll ask you to stand, and we'll sing about the mercy of the Lord.
Thank you.
so much. Please have a seat.
If you have your Bibles or a Bible app and you want to open it up to Deuteronomy chapter 6, that would be great. Father, as we come to your word, we give thanks that it is living and active, and that you desire to shape our lives according to the life of Jesus and according to the truth. So may we be attentive to your Spirit at work in us. Teach us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. So here we are at the third week of January. It's a critical time. It's a really critical time for many of us who have set goals or resolutions for this year. Anybody in that category understand what I'm talking about? Because statistically speaking, the majority of those goals have already been given up on, haven't they? Or maybe some of them are teetering on the edge. But today is not a day for bad news. Today is a day for good news. If one of your goals was to develop a better relationship with God, then today is a day of good news. Today, we are going to embark on a series that's going to challenge you to put some small habits into regular practice. Now, it will require you to change your posture towards a readiness and an anticipation for what God can yet do in your life and through your life. In order to do this, our leadership team, our governing board, we have agreed to use our statement of faith to set the content for this series. You can find our statement of faith on our website, sarniaemc.org. And if you click on the About Us link at the top, a tab at the top, then you'll see this page, a statement of faith, and then you just click on that. For some, this will be an opportunity to learn about developing a relationship with God. For others, it will provide a reminder to examine our foundations about, that's what Steve Bork talked about last week, examining our foundations in order to continue to mature in our relationship with God. So as we begin today, we want to clearly communicate this truth. We start with this statement: we believe in God. It's that simple. We believe in God. In our current culture, now that can mean different things to different people. In an age of spirituality, God can be trivialized or minimized and made to be ambiguous, maybe due to political correctness or maybe a fear of not offending others. But let me be clear. We believe in God. And in order to help us understand what that means from a Christian faith perspective, let's listen and learn from Moses in Deuteronomy chapter 6. Moses is standing before the people of Israel. God has chosen him to lead the people out of Egypt, away from injustice, out from under oppression and slavery. And together they have been following the leading of God for almost 40 years. Moses' earthly days are almost over. He knows this now. He knows that he won't be leading them into the promised land. In fact, 40 days from the time that he speaks these words, they are going to walk into that which God has prepared for them. God has heard their cries. He's been moved with compassion. He has entered into their circumstance, and he has been leading them through. And so as we come to chapter 6, let's listen to the choice that Moses presents to the Israelites and for those who would come after them, including us. Let's listen to these first three verses of chapter 6. These are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you're crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live, by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey, so that it may go well with you, and that you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, promised you. In these first three verses, Moses summarizes what he has been talking to the Israelites about over the first five chapters of this book. The first four chapters of Deuteronomy, Moses is recounting their history with them and how God has been their strength and their provider. And sometimes it can be difficult for us to remember the faithfulness of God in the past, especially when we're confronted with the changes or the obstacles that present themselves, or maybe the uncertainties that we have about the future. In the fifth chapter of Deuteronomy, Moses brings back to their memory the Ten Commandments. These are priorities and promises and practices that equip us to live lives that honor God. He has told them this before. He's reminding them again. So now in these first three verses, Moses is simply asking the people, do you desire to have God lead your life? That's a good question for us. Do you desire for your children and for the next generations to have the best opportunity to live their lives in manner that honors God? And then, will you shape your life according to the promises of God in order to experience the wholeness and assurance of His presence and grow confident of His promises? I think there are many, many of us who would say yes to at least one of these questions, if not more. I believe that there are those of us who have said yes to these at some point in the past, but have recognized that they haven't been diligent or faithful, or perhaps life happens and we get sidetracked by other priorities, maybe even discouraged by circumstances. To the Israelites and to us, Moses then says these words in verses 4 and 5. They are a confession of faith. And the first part is reminding us about who God is. And the second part is inviting us to respond to him. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. I want you to notice that first the setup is actually important. In verse 4, it says, hear, right? In fitness, now some of you know this much more than I do. In fitness, doing less with good posture provides more benefit than doing more with bad posture. You're injured less, and then you develop confidence through that consistency, which then allows you to increase your capacity. You know, it's really not very different in your relationship with God. A focus on your posture must be one that begins with a humility and a readiness to learn. Our setup or our approach to God is so key. When we're hurried or sporadic in our approach to this relationship with God, then we aren't in a position to receive the full benefits or understand the full depth of what He wants to communicate to us. Listen deeply is what Moses is saying. Listen deeply to understand, because you're loved by God. Listen deeply because God wants to communicate with you. Listen deeply because He is God, and you and I, we're not. So having a humble posture allows us to grow in our understanding and deepen our reverence of God. In the second part of verse 4 and in verse 5, we learn that, hey, this is our God. Moses says that the Lord, that is Jehovah, Yahweh, He is God and He is one. The Lord is one. What does that mean to us? I would propose that this is a really important concept despite its simplicity. There is no other. Moses was speaking to Israelites that had grown as a people despite the emphasis on idolatry of the ancient Egyptian culture into which they were born. And now, as they're about to cross over into a new land, they're going to be confronted with all kinds of different religious practices of other nations. And Moses is giving a warning. The warning is to remember that faith in God is singular. Faith is based on the promise, on promises that inspire hope beyond ourselves, not in ourselves. Faith is not sufficient in itself either. Faith must have an object, and if that object is not consistent, or worse, if that object becomes contradictory or divergent, then that faith is no longer singular. In fact, it's futile, and it'll be found lacking. I want you to understand also that faith is not religious practice or ritual. Rather, true faith for the Christian has a clear object, and that object is God. He is God. So religious practice should be careful to inspire faith that points to God alone, not to the practices themselves. Now, some might say, hey, wait a minute. Well, how does that relate to God the Father, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and the Holy Spirit of God? Now, many of you will be familiar with this concept that we call the Trinity, Father, Son, and Spirit. And a really good question is, how do they relate to this oneness or unity of God? Now, that's not just a good question. That is a great question. Thanks for asking. The word that is used here to describe God is key. We read these words, the Lord is one. Now, we've just finished speaking about the singularity of God amid diversity of religious systems. So here, Moses is reminding the people of the unity of God. And that word one, used to describe that unity, is used throughout the Bible to describe a coming together of multiple factors. Let me show you three examples so you can understand. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 5. It's the very first use of this word one or unity. It's translated differently in our English words, often for first. But we read, there was evening and there was morning. It was the first day. That first is that same word as one. And so even here we see a unity, the unity of one day, with the idea of plurality made up of evening and then morning. Morning and evening, there was one day, there was a first day. That is the same idea, that concept of unity. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, it's a verse that I often first go to when I sit down with people who are getting married. God uses this idea of two becoming one flesh. Again, a man and a woman united become one. We understand that maybe a little bit more in that sense. And then in the book of Exodus, in chapter 26, as God is giving Moses instructions on how to build the temple, he talks about 50 golden clasps that are to be used to hold the curtains together to separate between the altar. And so the tent would be one. He talks about it being one, a unity being made up of many parts. You see, this term in the original language, and there's other examples of that as we read through our Bibles. This term in its original language does not communicate exclusivity or singularity at this time. There are other words that God could have chosen to put in for that. This word then actually prophetically at this point speaks forward, points forward to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ and his ministry, and then also the ministry of the Holy Spirit who would come when Jesus ascended to those who would receive him, who call on his name and acknowledge him as Lord and Savior. The Apostle Paul speaks of this relationship in this way. In 1 Corinthians chapter 8, he says, "Yet for us there is but one God, the Father from whom all things came and for whom we live. And there is but one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom all things came and through whom we live." There is a unity that is spoken of in there. Jesus also affirms these relationships in his words to us in John chapter 16. He says, "But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes," speaking of the Holy Spirit, "he will guide you into all truth. But he will not speak on his own. He will only speak what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will glorify me." The Spirit will glorify Jesus because it is from me that he will receive what he's going to make known to you. So the Spirit's going to take what he receives from Jesus and teach us. "And all that belongs to the Father is mine," Jesus says. "That is why I said the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you." And so that which belongs to the Father is given to the Son, and the Son is giving that to the Holy Spirit, and together in oneness, they are ministering to us. The unity of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is based on their shared character and purpose. They are united in that. Let me just take a quick look at some of these characteristics. For the sake of time, unfortunately, I'm not going to go to any of these references that I'm going to mention. I'm just going to give you a brief description. If you'd like to talk about that or look at that a little bit more later, then I'm happy to be able to work that, provide those with you, provide those to you if you'd like to. But here's some key characteristics that Father, Son, and Holy Spirit share. One, that they are eternal. God has no beginning or no end. This is true for all three. He has always existed because he is not limited to the finiteness of our time, and therefore we can have confidence in who he is. God is holy. That means God is separate from all that is unclean and evil. He is pure and distinct from all others. And this is the primary way. This is the primary way that God desires to be known throughout all of the Bible. That God is holy means that anything that falls short of his standard of holiness has to be separated from him. He has made us, though, with a desire for the purity of holiness, which causes us to search for a way to be found holy so that we can be near to God. And that way has been provided through Jesus Christ. And we'll talk more about the effective work of Jesus Christ next week. God is also unchangeable. Now, this doesn't mean that God is inactive or apathetic. Bible scholars like to use the term immutable to communicate the fact that God is always consistent in his character. And therefore, we can have great assurance of that God's promises will not fail, that his attitude towards sin will not change, and he will not compromise or neglect his standard of holiness. God is also omnipotent. Omnipotence means that God is all-powerful and able to do anything. Catch this, God is able to do anything that is consistent with his nature. And additionally, there are times when God restrains from using all of his power, even if it would be consistent with his character, for reasons that are only known to him and unknown to us on this side of eternity. And that's sometimes hard. Let's acknowledge that. Most notably, though, we can understand that he did not choose to intervene even when his own son, Jesus Christ, was punished and crucified unjustly. By his power, he created the world. He rescued Israel. Most significantly, he raised Jesus from the dead, which then allows him to move your hearts and mine to the opportunity to place our faith in him. God is omniscient. God knows everything, things that are and things that are possible. And therefore, any warning that he gives or any encouragement or command that he provides, we can trust that. God not only knows the fullness of what has happened, he also knows what may happen or what might have happened. And we can find comfort in recognizing what ultimate good and glory will come from events that we cannot understand. His omniscience should still us. He is omnipresent. And that means God is present everywhere. He's everywhere present in his whole being at all times. Be careful with this. That doesn't mean he is fragmented within the universe, which leads us to idolizing the creation instead of the creator. Rather, the fullness of God can be discovered in all places of the world. God is righteous. And in his righteousness, that relates to the idea of justice. His character, it's not justice isn't what he does. These things isn't what God does. This is who he is. His character is righteousness. We can trust him because there's no action that he's going to take that will violate his holiness. And God is sovereign, that he is in complete control of all things, even while he allows certain events to occur according to the natural laws that he has put in place, or the consequences to the circumstances or choices that we make that disregard his holiness. He is still sovereign in our relationship with him and with others. And God is love. Love is not something that God does. Love is who he is. It's his nature. It's his character. His love seeks the good for others in accordance with his holiness. And this is so important, as there are many who would subscribe to a falsehood that the love of God outweighs his holiness. But this isn't so. Rather, because of his great love, grace becomes the means by which we are invited and received by God, who sends his Son, Jesus Christ, that we might respond to this great love. Because of the love of God, we discover goodness and mercy, long-suffering and justice, all of which are united according to his holiness. And so if this is who God is, then what ought to be our response? Let me invite you back into Deuteronomy chapter 6, starting in verse 6. These commandments I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, and when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Don't miss this part. Moses is saying that in view of God, in view that God is sovereign over all the world, how will you respond personally? Do you have a relationship with God? Have you acknowledged that need? Have you acknowledged that you need the God who loves you to lead your life? When we understand that, then we can move forward to the next part. Because notice then what he says next. For those who establish their faith in him, he says, that's good enough. You can just stop right there. No, he doesn't say that. He says, now you can do whatever you want. You've got your ticket. Nope. Now you can actually tell God what to do. But he doesn't actually say that either. He says, impress them on our children. Talk about them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. Our faith in God should inform our daily lives. Knowing who God is in his character should be reflected in the way that we conduct ourselves, particularly with the next generations. How many of us care about what happens to our next generations? Our understanding of God and his truth should inform our discussions, should guide our actions and influence our thinking. Our daily lives should have the evidence of who God is. You know, Jesus would summarize all that Moses would say with this command to us. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, Jesus says. And then, he says, and love your neighbor as yourself. This isn't easy. Our hearts can be easily drawn by other affections. Our soul can be distracted by busyness and a false sense of success. And our mind can be consumed with worry and fear. And so we look for love from people or experiences. And it's no wonder that we find that it's hard to love others because we're not experiencing or receiving the love of God for us. We may even believe that God doesn't love us because we've allowed our focus or our goals to shift to other objects that leave no lasting fulfillment. Life is hard, but God is greater. Understand who he is and how he is already intersecting with your life. And when we start to understand that, it allows us to grow in our love for him as we place our faith in Jesus Christ. Why is this important? Because, as I just said, life is hard. I want to tell you the story of a man named Manuel. I met him for the first time a week ago. I saw him for likely the last time 2 days ago. In the time it took on one hot, dusty morning on an El Salvadoran mountainside to build this house, our team learned why it's so important to love God. Manuel is a big, strong man who daily cares for a herd of cattle. Manuel's a farmer who likes to milk cows. That's his job. Do you know what time he gets up? 4 a.m. every single day to go to work for another farmer. He comes home by 4:30 in the afternoon, and he goes to bed between 7 or 8, and he rises the next day, and he does it all again. He's a hard, hard-working man, and he rarely gets a day off. Can you just go to that next slide there, Nathan? Thanks. You know, one of the mantras of our cultural religion of success is, if you work hard enough, you'll be successful, and you can become anything that you want to be. It's not true. It is not true. If our small g God is success, you're going to tire yourself out, and you're going to lose yourself in it. Does God love Manuel? Does God want the best for Manuel? Before you answer, let me tell you just a little bit more. Manuel's wife, passed away unexpectedly 4 years ago. He's a single father. His son Eric is 9 years old and is going into grade 4 in a couple of weeks' time. Eric, the son, loves to work with his dad. He gets up with his dad and he goes and he milks cows. He adores his father. And you see the picture over there. His father has an incredible, compassionate love for his son. And living where they do and experiencing what they have, and by virtue of catching glimpses of how others in the world live, it's obvious that Manuel was carrying a weight in his soul when we met him. We could look at him and understand without words of translation the query of his heart. If God loves me, then why is this so hard? If we believe in God, how do we deal with or respond to these circumstances of life? And how do we help others to do the same? As Manuel dug holes for his house and he helped put the walls together, it was obvious that there was something very purposeful in how he went about these things. Everything was done well. He even took the time to throw dirt from one side to the next to level out the floor of his home. And as he worked with his son, his smile on his face, so they could share this, because they were sharing this experience together. And it was in this and through what he told us about his life that we could then remind him that God already sees him, that God has been hearing his prayer, and that God loves him and his son so much that he moved some people who don't get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, he moved some of them thousands of kilometers to remind him that he is worthy, that he is loved. Even in his circumstances. That God has given him a capacity to work hard without complaining, according to the rhythm of God's creation, from morning to night. Every day is a good day. He reflected that goodness of God. It was evident to us that God's original design, his hard working capacity, morning to night. He has given his son an example, not only of these things, but also of compassionate selflessness. You know, we've worked in these communities for a long time. It's too often that men abandon their wives and their children, or are indifferent even to their children. He had this compassion that was so compelling, and in these things, we were all reminded that God was not absent from him. We weren't bringing God to him. We were receiving the goodness of God through his life. And but we could invite him to understand the importance of having faith in God, because God had loved him. And God had a son. And he gave his son, Jesus, his one and only son, so that whoever believes in him would not perish. That is, they wouldn't be destroyed by following the gods of success, but they could find eternal life in his name. Understanding the love of God and responding to the love of God would give him the daily strength and the eternal hope to grow in reflecting this love to his son and to others around him, even if his life circumstances never changed. Life is hard, but God is greater. Understanding who he is and how he's already intersecting and involved in our lives allows us to grow in our love for him as we place our faith in Jesus Christ. Let's pray together. Father, we You are God. We are not. And we confess that we can confuse that. We confess that we can put up idols of success or popularity or beauty or achievement ahead of a desire to live for you. We confess that we are slow to listen. But thank you for this reminder that you are present, that you hear our prayer, that you love us, that you are revealing yourself to us in different ways through the circumstances of life. And God, sometimes we're so busy and that we can't see it. So God, would you help us to reflect on how you are at work among us and around us? Thank you that faith is not just a word, but faith in God. As Father, Son, and Holy Spirit changes our lives, transforms our lives. But Father, we give ourselves to you and ask that you would continue to lead us. Would you teach us what it means to give thanks to you because of who you are, your character, your holiness, your righteousness, your sovereignty, your great love. Guide us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to conclude our service together today by singing about the name of Jesus, and we'll ask you to stand if you're able to, and we'll sing together.
Well, it's good to be back together again, at least for me. I always miss when I'm not here to be with you. Let me send you off with these words. May the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you've suffered a little while, may he himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. And all God's people said, amen. And if you've got a word for this year or a verse that comes to mind, let me encourage you to write that on the bulletin board in the foyer as well. Go in peace. God be with you. Have a great week. Remember to pray for our upward teams as they get going this week.